My name is Ricardo Cortez, and I am a professor at Tulane University. I don't remember if I was good at math when I was really young. I remember in seventh grade, I remember being good enough that I could answer questions that my teachers asked me. For example, I remember there was a time when three of us in class were playing around. We were doing something we weren't supposed to be doing. In class, when the teacher turned around, we would throw a ball or something like that and catch it. And of course, the teacher eventually caught us. And so he got upset and threatened us with something or whatever. And then I thought that was it. But then later in the class, he wrote a problem on the board and he pointed at me and said to come up to the board and do it. He thought he was going to show me who was in power there. But in fact, I was good enough at that time that I could do it. And so I think after that point, I think I thought I was good at math. I'm not sure that there was a moment when I thought I wanted to be a mathematician. I think I became a mathematician before I knew I wanted to be one, if that makes any sense. I didn't start studying mathematics in college. I was studying engineering. Like many of us, my family thought engineering was a good career for somebody who liked math. And they didn't know anything about mathematics being something like a career or a profession. So I started studying engineering, and I was running out of math classes to take, and I wanted to take more math classes. So somehow I ended up adding a math major, and I then accidentally went to graduate school. It was not really planned very well. I had a friend who graduated with me from undergraduate in math, and she went to graduate school. She was a good friend of mine, and we would talk sometimes, and she was telling me, oh, you would like it here, you should go to grad school, come here. And I said, okay, I'll give it a try. And so I applied to go to grad school there, and I also applied for jobs in engineering. And my big plan was, if they accept me in grad school, I'll just go there, and if they don't accept me, then I'll just get a job. And fortunately, they accepted me. My area of interest is usually called computational fluid dynamics. And so this is, I think, is still part of my engineering training in a way that is still in me. So it has to do with writing mathematical equations and usually write computer codes that go with those equations in order to do simulations of how fluids move. And the fluids could be liquids or they could be gases. So the typical model that people know about is weather modeling, right? So you see it on TV when you see storms approaching or things like that. But there's lots of different kinds of fluids and lots of motions of swimming things, for example. And so I'm interested in how microorganisms swim around and move the fluid around. And so we want to be able to make models so that are accurate and feasible to use so that we can study some other scientific questions. When I was a student, there were different kinds of struggles, I guess. First of all, I was born in this country, but I didn't grow up in this country. I grew up in El Salvador. And from age 4 to age 18. So then I came back to the United States to go to college. And I thought I knew English. But of course, I came to this country like, let's say, a week before the semester started. And so I was thrown into college campuses, living in the dorms, And this was a kind of a shocking thing for me, both culturally and linguistically and in various ways. So it was a little bit of a struggle at the beginning just to keep up with the English and what was happening in my classes and things like that. Later on, I went from being an undergraduate at Arizona State University, which is a fine school, to going to graduate school in UC Berkeley. And I didn't think that I was prepared enough to be in the PhD program at Berkeley. That first year was a huge struggle, but it was kind of a collective struggle with a lot of other people. I didn't feel that it was targeting me specifically. Lots of people I saw come and go. Later in as a postdoc and then as a faculty member, there are different kinds of things that happen. People sometimes talk to you in ways that are not respectful, or they don't think you belong where you are, and they say that to you, and things like that. You would think that maybe somebody would just say, look, you can just ignore that, right? The person doesn't know you, they don't know who you are, who cares? But the fact is that it affects you. Fortunately, they don't come around too often in those episodes. So you learn to deal with them, I guess. Getting my PhD was a big accomplishment and probably my proudest accomplishment in terms of my career. It was great for my family and for me to accomplish that. And I really felt like I had achieved something. But then, of course, that's just the beginning of your career, right? And in your career, you do all kinds of things to advance yourself, but also to try to help others advance. I got involved in summer programs for undergraduates early on. I was a grad student when I first worked for a summer program at Berkeley. It was called the Summer Math Institute. Later on, I was part of some other program. And when it came to, just by accident, I was invited to give a presentation at the Mathematical Sciences Research Institute one time. Not about mathematics, but about summer programs, as a matter of fact. And so I give my presentation on how I viewed summer programs and what they did and didn't do for undergraduate students. And the director of the MSRI at the time came to me afterwards and said, do you think we can do that here? And so I jumped at the opportunity. So we established the MSRI UP, the MSRI undergraduate program. And this was in 2007. And now, after all these years, it's still going strong and it has served many students who, and it was created specifically to attract students who, like me, like I was, didn't know very much about graduate school, didn't have anybody talking to them about graduate school. They don't have parents that are professors or things like that, but that are good at math and could probably do very well in graduate school if they wanted to, but they just didn't have the circle of people that can talk to them about that. Yeah, of course I had role models in my career. Some of them don't know they were my role models, and some of them do. So I don't know if this is what others think of role models, but I like to observe people when they have positions of power, for example, if they're chairs of departments or deans or big shots or something. I like to watch them and see what they do and how they behave. And so they don't know that I'm doing this, but I'm paying attention to how they use what power they have and whether they use it to advance themselves or just a small group of inner circle, or if they use it to advance a larger community and to do things. And so I use this as inspiration, I guess. So when I see something that I really like, I just think of that person when I when I'm facing some decision, of course, I've had mentors that were assigned or that I chose for specific purposes. And there are people that I admire very much, but I think I have a mentor in my head that is a combination of all these people somehow. Everybody looks for a balance in their lives. And you're going to have to look for a balance between your mathematics and the rest of your life. Nobody can tell you where the balance is because that's a very personal decision. But one thing that I can say is that you need to take care of yourself. You need to advance yourself. Make sure you keep adding successes to your professional life, because that's going to open more doors for you to be involved in the communities that you care about. And if you don't do that, then you're going to have limited influence. Even for some of us, it might feel that it's selfish to do something, to spend this year just worrying about me, my math, my career, my papers, whatever. But these are the things that we get measured with or against. And that's what's going to open some doors for me to do certain things that I can't do right now. So when you're looking for a balance, this is my words of wisdom. Always check your balance and make sure you're doing the things that make you happy. And make sure you understand that self-improvement professionally is going to lead to more influence in the other aspects of your life.